Hi, I'm Alister Clyne. This is Hillside Dairies, and we're farming at Tanamba West in east, well, central Gippsland. We're milking 1,200 cows through 16 DeLaval V300 robots. We are a pasture-based dairy. We've got about 250 to 280 hectares that goes into the milking area. But we have other support country as well. It's actually a really great place to milk cows with the heat extremes. And it's mild through the winter, it's not particularly cold. And we grow grass all year. We commissioned the new dairy in July 2023. And before that, we were milking through a 50 unit rotary. We've milked up to 1400 cows in that dairy. Now we use it to milk our fresh, lame and sick herds. We keep them out of the robots. When we put in the dairy, the new robot dairy, we wanted to remain pasture based. So grazing, we definitely wanted the four-way grazing. We'd seen that that was very successful in other areas. You know, they'd learned from two-way to three-way to four-way. And four-way definitely ticks the boxes in terms of getting better visitation throughout the day and utilisation of your robots. And so they went about designing the yards and all that sort of thing with the smart selection gates to be able to make that happen, make it work. And so we've ended up with a dairy with 10 drafting zones. The farm is sort of a big square and the dairy is right in the middle. So this farm lended itself to basically one robotic dairy being quite big. The furthest paddock is 1.3 kilometres to the gate. And so that is about the limit. We've planned for 75 cows per robot. And that is, like, we've milked up to 1180 in here so far. We haven't hit the 1200. I think we still had 25% idle time. So there's plenty of room, yeah. Particularly if you split your calving, you're calving flat. We've got to a point now with the technology that the limit is biology. You know, it's actually the cow can't give the milk any faster. Or they can, but only within certain limits, you know. So yeah, so we've got a mixed herd, Jerseys and Holsteins. And there was a bit of talk about, you know, how do you go getting the robot right for a mix, you know, like, because what would suit one cow won't suit the next, size and things like that. So we set the box up for the average cow. We certainly aren't breeding for super big cows. So we're sort of moderate size Holsteins and big Jerseys. That's our intention. That's our breeding. That's what we're trying to do, our target. The V300 definitely, it just sort of did it. You know, you can adjust the box, you can move the feed manger in and out to suit the size of the cow. We set up the width in the intermediate size. There's three different sizes, we put it in the middle. And like on a very small cow, it can give you some grief, like, you know, time, like a Jersey heifer can scooch across and try and be funny. But eventually, after a while, they settle down and they just stand where they should and they get milked. We got the dairy up and running July last in 2023, and we batched the cows through the system. We pretty much introduced 1,000 cows over 4 days because we committed to it. We were just gonna do it. Once they were trained to the robots and we went voluntary, you just set the gates for every 6 hours. You know, a new area would open up and the other one would close off, and it just worked, they figured it out. It is a bit like that with robots. You worry about the big stuff initially, just getting cows milked, making sure the robots are maintained, changing inflations, that sort of thing, watching your incompletes, to fine tuning it. You know, like those little things start to worry you. The 10 cows that just won't come through twice a day. And so probably by the second season, which we're in now, full 12 months through, and like we're comfortable, we're confident about it, We know how everything reacts. There's still more to learn because the cows are doing a little bit different stuff all the time. How you manage your grass, because that same old thing is like, yeah, if you're, like I've said it 1,000 times, like you put robots in, it doesn't make you a better or worse farmer. You're the same farmer. Whatever it is, you got to do it well. And so if you're doing a good job of your conventional system, and you're not afraid of technology, you don't have to be a real computer whiz or anything like that. But if you're sort of a problem solving sort of person, you don't mind solving problems, like, because that's how you deal with all business, is something pops up and you try and deal with it and get a good result. You're just applying that to robots now. And the beauty is that we're not getting up at 2 o'clock in the morning to go and fetch cows and milk them conventionally. And fatigue is definitely like not an issue now. We're here for a long time still. We're still here for 10 hours a day generally, sort of 5:30 till 5:30 with a couple of hours break. But we're not physically buggered. After milking 1,200 cows through a rotary, you're cooked. You're ready to go home. And if you do your fresh and sick cows at the end of milking, then your focus, your care factor, you just can't help it. It's just not there to the same level as it should be. Whereas here, cows are getting milked, they're just doing the business. So it's like, it's a great system, yeah. So people have done robots before, but no one's milked this many cows quite through one system. So it is a bit of a, like, crikey, that's a push maybe. And, you know, so the idea, oh, maybe split it in two dairies, make it easier for yourself. And it's like, oh, so efficient doing it this way, right, the way we've done it. And I had confidence in DeLaval after seeing what they've done on other farms. They've learnt a lot in the process. Like, it's been a journey for them too. And, you know, I saw a farm in Tasmania that was doing a great job. Nick Dornoff's farm down there, Gala, milking eight robots, milking 600 cows, and it was just poof, it was singing. And I thought, I just want that with twice as many cows. I just want that, please. And DeLaval delivered it, like they did. And actually, I can't use the language I would use, but the pain that I thought I was going to incur with breakdowns, trouble with technology, not wanting to do what it should do, you know, glitchiness, things like that, it didn't materialize at all. It didn't happen. Let's just do what we know is bulletproof. And they did that and it's worked. One person could run this dairy, like no worries at all. Trying to farm for Christmas Day, you know, like, what do you want to do on Christmas Day? Well, you don't want to be here. You want to be at home with your family and stuff. And so anyway, yeah, so the question I'll get is, oh, you know, from 1,000 cow operators and that, oh, how are the robots going? And most of the time I say, yeah, great. Yeah, great. And after a while, I'm like, shit, I've got to come up with an answer that doesn't sound too rosy, because, you know, I've got to put in all the, you know, there's some challenges, like, but, you know, you deal with it. And so it's sort of like, oh, how do I make this not so good? Like, there is definitely challenges, and there's times where we've been cooked, but there's other things going on. We're irrigating. Yeah, you've still got staff challenges, even though you've changed the way your people work in the business. You've still got all those things going on, but at least the robots are taking care of milking the cows. And like, we make sure they're good and they do the job. And you know, that's the one thing, you know, you talk to anyone, like a DeLaval robot will milk a cow. It's everything around that dictates the success, milking of a cow and the business. You know, when I was doing my research for the robots, I was going through all of them and all the different brands and looking at what they were doing and how they were setting them up. And so the big things that I really liked about the V300 robot in particular was that one cup at a time, it's a small target for that cow to mess with. And if she does boot the cup off, then it just gets dragged back up and it has another go. And eventually a cow generally gives up, you know. The robot's a lot more patient than I would be, that's for sure. I don't know how that camera works and all of that, but and the smoothness of the hydraulic system and the valving and everything. But it's just so smooth and pretty much like it doesn't have to think too hard. And so the likelihood of good attachment was better, I thought. And that's why that was one of the major things. The next thing was that the robot, it's a box robot, and it's set up to be repaired without you getting too filthy. All the milking equipment is there in the cassette, or the magazine rather. All the valves and the shut-off valves, the vacuum and the milk pump, it's all there in the cabinet, right there in front of you. There's some complicated stuff going on, but they've made it seem simple. I mean, look, milking cows and robots is the future of the job here in Australia, one way or the other, around the world, really. Like getting up really early, finishing late, physically, your shoulders. So one of the big things about going to robots for me was that when our staff got to 60, they couldn't keep going. They had to move to a different farm or change roles or something because it was just too intense on their bodies. And I just thought like, yeah, with the robots, you can keep a great employee for however long they wish to go, you know? It's the physical side of it's out of the picture. So that's huge. With a good robotic system and everything going well, you could see yourself keep milking. You're not like, oh geez, I can't wait to hang the apron up. You know, it's if you love farming, you'll it's going to allow you to do it for longer, for sure.